Thank you, Jim, for sparing time for this interaction.
It's my pleasure.
To start off with, Jim, you're a strong proponent of agility, right? What do you feel are the challenges in adopting agile operations in enterprises? And as a CTO, how are you helping them overcome these challenges?
Yeah, well, I'd say that the number one challenge people have in adopting agile is the empowerment of the individual. You know, that I think agile works best when the individuals on a team, on an engineering team, choose their tasks, they pull the tasks rather than have them assigned. And especially in India, that creates a real challenge for teams because people work very hard to get to a management level. And when they get to a management level or a supervisor level, they want to be able to tell other people what to do, right? And agile isn't about that. I mean, if it's executed optimally, right? It's about everybody on the team being equal and the team owning units of work and the team delivering a unit of work that they commit to, right? And when that happens, the team drives themselves harder than any manager could possibly drive them externally. But the challenge is getting people to let go of ownership and task assignment and that sort of thing, right? But we really find that agile is the best way to deliver in a distributed development environment. A lot of people think it's not really suitable, but because you're constantly delivering a stream of usable artifacts, you don't have to rely on trust. So the people in the United States can see what you're working on. You always have a working system, continuously working system, gets more and more featureful over time. So I would say that it's the human factors that are the most challenging for agile. And everybody always wants to compromise on it and not follow the actual principles of agile. When you do, you get spectacular results. I mean, we've seen people, one recent engagement that we had, we saw 6 times improvement in productivity over a 9-month period. And we saw a 90% reduction in defect rates at the end of the project, right? And that's because they really committed to do it. But most people adopt it kind of halfway. Like we're working with one company right now that instead of having a blended QA team and development team working side by side, people sit on different floors of the same building. They communicate only by telephone, only at the management level, right? And so the success they're going to get is very, very limited. They turn it into a series of mini waterfalls. It's very challenging. Yeah.
So how are you as a CTO helping corporates overcome this challenge?
Well, we find that we have to work with the executives. It's got to be the executives who mandate it. So there's a top-down push for Agile. One of the challenges of Agile, again, is a human challenge, is that it surfaces problems very early, that you really can't hide issues. And lots of teams are used to hiding what's wrong until the integration period, and then everything blows up, right? But with Agile, what you're doing is you're exposing problems as they happen. So you have to have a very high trust environment, where the CEO sees everything that's going wrong. You're operating in an environment of transparency. So you have to get empowerment at the top. We do training of the executives, like the one that I mentioned, the example I mentioned with that, you know, 6 times productivity improvement. We started working with the CEO, we trained the executive team, and then we started working with the individual engineers. They loved it once they had the chance to use it. So
as a CTO, it is really important to scale up as the organization scales.
Yeah.
How do you do that?
Well, when I joined GlobalLogic 6 years ago, we were 1,200 people. Now we're about 9,000 people. So we've grown very rapidly. I think you have to move from a point where you're very hands-on, and you know, like I started out designing internal systems for GlobalLogic, working with teams to help them become more agile and so on, to being more of an evangelist. And that's how I've adapted. I think in a CTO role in general, you have to be more forward-looking. You know, you have to recognize the trends, you have to make people aware of the trends, and you have to help the organization transform and keep a focus on your business model and on delivering value for your customers.
So on the one hand, we say it's important to scale up.
Yep.
But on the other hand, people also say that leaner software teams are more productive.
They are.
So what is your take on it?
Definitely. I think a small, sharp team will outperform a large, bloated team every time. Like we dealt recently with a well-established travel company that has 5,000 engineers. And 5,000 engineers, half of them are contractors. And the productivity level is very low compared to what they could do with a few hundred people who are extremely, who are organized as you know, self-sustaining teams and very high productivity. So it's pretty amazing. And I think there's going to be a lot of people either out of a job or finding new types of ways to engage as these lean practices and agile practices are adopted, you know. Yeah. Because there's a real premium on results, right? And what you find in any kind of large organization is it's maybe 20% of your people who are really delivering the results. Again, with Agile, you can't hide, right? So you find out it's like a singing in a choir, right? You know every single voice, and the person who doesn't sing very well really stands out, right? And Agile's like that. If not everyone on your team is productive, the team as a whole is going to suffer. And when you have a healthy Agile culture, the team will reject a person who's not performing. The team themselves. I've had my Agile teams come to me and say, you know, Jim, you need to fire this person. Because he's dragging us down, you know? And so the team, because the team is taking responsibility for delivering results instead of just filling out forms or making, you know, making things look good and so on. It's very different.
Sure. But given the security threat landscape today,
yes,
it's really important to build secure solutions.
Absolutely. Which
should, and I feel it should start right at the coding level.
Yes, absolutely.
How do you ensure that your solutions, your products that you build are secure?
Well, at GlobalLogic, we use a variety of tools, you know, to Coverity and other tools to make sure to do static code inspection. We do dynamic penetration testing. We do code reviews systematically. I mean, we have a whole security process for regular audits. Like you said, you really got to build into the ground up, but it's not antagonistic to Agile. You know, Agile doesn't mean sloppy. You know, Agile can mean actually very, very rigorous. And what you, kind of the key to the whole thing is you have to have a definition of done, right? That says that a unit of work is not done until it's been inspected, until it's undergone security, penetration testing, static code analysis, all the other things that are needed to ensure a secure solution, architecture reviews, things like that. None of that is antagonistic to Agile. It can all be built within a rigorous Agile methodology. We have two variants of Agile that we use. One of them is called carrier grade Agile, which is for telcos, which are very heavily regulated and also have, you know, five nines reliability standards. So it's a very rigorous application of Agile. We also use Agile to develop regulated medical devices, like programmers for heart pacemakers, neural implants, that's work is done here in India, by the way, diabetes pumps, things that are implanted in your body that are critical to health and safety. And we develop many of those using Agile methodologies and following FDA regulated processes. So it's entirely possible and there's no inconsistency between rigor and Agile and lean.
So what do you feel are the top three ingredients that go into making a great tech product?
One of the things that we're very strong on here is user-centric design. So we have, about 4 years ago, we acquired a company called Method, which is one of the premier design companies in the world. They compete with Frog and IDEO and many others. And they have a methodology around that products need to be based on the user. How do you monitor, you know, like my watch or my iPhone or you know, your tablet and things like that. Those have all come out of Apple's user-centric design philosophy, anticipating what would delight your user, right? So it all starts with the user, and then the design process drives the engineering process, right? So we get a lot of innovation that way. We work with a lot of clients on, we have an engagement we're working on right now, for example, with one of the big telephone carriers to do Internet of Things, you know, so for smart cities. So what are some of the innovative ways that you can address the problems of cities around the world? And we're enlisting our Method subsidiary and others to do ideation, you know, to come up with new concepts, new ideas, and then that drives the development process.
What do you feel are the top two or three trends emerging in the field of tech product development?
Well, on a technical level, I would say event-driven architectures are one of the key things that we've moved over the years from different types of architectures. Like 10 years ago, J2EE and SOA were very very popular, very big. But I think since the advent of mobile devices about 7-8 years ago, and the mobile-first architectures, the architectures have become increasingly event-driven, meaning that the front-end device has a lot of intelligence. Like a smartphone is more powerful than a, you know, your desktop computer of, what, 5 years ago? Something like that. So so it has a lot of intelligence. So all of the navigation and intelligence in dealing with the users are on either the smart device or in a JavaScript application running on a web browser. And then the back end, we've moved to something like a client-server architecture again with this event-driven architecture, so that the front end carries a lot of intelligence about interaction and asks the back end for information as they need it. And they register a series of events, and the back end supplies the information that's required, right? Instead of the back end presenting information to the end user. And that's really significant because what it's enabled is the Internet of Things, for example, and location-based services, and a lot of the things, advertising, context-aware advertising, a lot of the things that are evolving right now come out of these event-driven, the event-driven architecture technology, right? So I'd say that's extremely significant. Obviously, mobile is the biggest thing that's driven all sorts of innovation, like we were talking about before. Over the last, the iPhone shipped in 2007, which is only 8 years ago. Unbelievably, the iPad shipped 2 years after that, in 2009. And 6 years is all. And it's completely transformed my life, and I think most people's lives. We interact with everybody using our tablets and our mobile devices now. And that's completely changed people's expectations about usability, again, leading back to the design-led development, right? Because you see the best of the world in what Apple is doing, what Microsoft is now doing, what many companies are now doing. You can just download it for free over the App Store for 99 cents, and you have a world-class product. So the mobility has, both by becoming a primary means of interacting with the world, and also by enabling access to this really great technology, has really radically altered people's expectations for software development. Even for internal IT-oriented systems, CIO-developed systems, the expectations of the workers have gone from just being, simple form-based applications to they want something world-class, right? So I'd say event-driven architectures, mobile-first systems, and then the third one would be the cloud, and which has completely changed the economics of software development. And it's enabling tremendous innovation, tremendous changes in business models, where very small companies, like Facebook originally was, they weren't on the cloud, but same sort of concept, right? That companies can start very small, have a great idea, and then they can scale seamlessly to billions of users or hundreds of millions of users. And it's there's a lot of stories like that, in games and other areas. And it's just astonishing that you don't need that kind of capital investment to connect with the entire planet and to be able to scale your application to that level, So I think those three trends. Fourth one, you only asked for three. Fourth one would be high quality open source software. Things like MongoDB and Hadoop and in the big data space and, things like Nginx and many of the other things in the event-driven architecture space are completely transforming the economics of software development, where you're not paying these huge royalties to, the last generation of vendors. So again, enabling this nimble style of software development.
So in the light of these developments, how do you see the role of the CTO changing going forward?
Well, and within a company like GlobalLogic, where we do product development services, my role is more to spread the knowledge across different clients, because we'll learn something about process, for example, working with a medical device company, that might be very applicable to a telephone company or most recently, self-driving cars. We're working with some companies doing self-driving cars and autonomous driving systems and things like that, so which have very high levels of safety. So what I see my role as being is propagating lessons learned in one area to a completely different area. What we learned in embedded software might apply to e-commerce and so on. What we learn about the Android operating system we can use for IoT or in-vehicle infotainment systems based on Android and other operating systems. So there's just tremendous cross-pollination. And being in a company like GlobalLogic, kind of, I like to compare it to being in a continual trade show where we can't share anything proprietary, but we get to see all the trends and we get to work with some of the world-leading companies, and they educate us and we learn on the job, and we can apply learnings in one area to a totally, apparently totally unrelated area. So that's one of the things really exciting about my job. I'd say in a more traditional software company, the CTO role needs to be to make people uncomfortable, I think. There are a lot of companies that we work with that are software companies and ones that have found themselves, woke up one morning and found they have to start acting like software companies. There's a lot of complacency about what they've been doing, and they may have a 70% market share in a niche today, but that doesn't mean, you know, in a year from now they'll even be in existence anymore, right? Because you get a competitor like an Uber or a Lyft or something like that in the car space, and suddenly your existing taxi business, which is driving huge streams of revenue, is under threat. You know, so the technology enables these new business models, and I think the CTO's role needs to be able to confront the existing way you make money and help the organization transform.